Welcome everybody to Genealogy Carlentini Omaha and Beyond. It's July 25th. We are 1 week away from the start of the Santa Lucia Festival in Omaha, and I guess a week and a half more, like, but anyway. And we've got Eleonora is in Omaha, I understand. Joanne was just telling me about the ladies' luncheon that you guys had, so that's great. And Marianne, I saw you nod. Were you at that lunch too?
No, there was a mix-up on the invitation, and I don't know if they really had the lunch. I don't know. I talked to Eleonora yesterday.
Yes.
She said it was a mix-up.
Yes.
Okay. Mix-up on the invitation, I guess. Mm-hmm.
So, Monica, you said that you were headed to Utah. Are you there yet, or are you still in Omaha? You're muted.
We leave next Tuesday.
Next Tuesday?
Yeah, we'll be gone for a week and a half.
Got some childcare duties?
Yeah, they're a little older, 12 and 14, so it won't be so bad.
Yeah, well, we used to go there almost on an annual pilgrimage because my mother-in-law lived in Elko, Nevada. And we'd fly to Salt Lake, and then we'd go to Elko for a bit, and then we'd stay in Park City and drive down to the library.
Recording in progress.
That's a nice library.
Hi.
Hi, Nora.
Ciao.
Awesome. Dove, Eleonora.
Sono a casa di Sherry. I'm Sherry's house.
Casa di Sherry. Okay.
She's in the kitchen. I'm in the living room.
She needs a sign out front.
Hey, you're late.
I'm on. I told you to get on.
Oh, look at her.
Susan Finley just joined us. Hi, Susan.
Ciao a tutti.
So, I haven't seen Silvana join us yet. I don't know if she was planning to join or not, but I didn't see Scott either, but she sent me some information, more information on the Regalia family. So we're working on that.
Okay.
And I got your message about Lou Rotella. And he says his mom is Carlentinese, and of course the Rotella family is Calabria.
Sí.
No, but
we want his family.
Her family.
Is he Calabria or
Rotella's mother's family? He will visit Carlentini in September, so I'm trying to find some. Connections. I know that he's related with the Ansaldo, and he said other family names. But if I'll find some alive relatives, I would love to introduce them to him. He's staying at the Badiula, the friends who came last year in the trip. They know it. Is there Chris or Connie here? Let me see. No, Meg. No. It's okay. So,
Silvana.
I met him yesterday.
Ciao,
ragazzi. Ciao. Ciao, Silvana. Benvenuta.
Grazie.
So, with Thomas Lamantia, who's going to be over there soon, I think before you get back. And I realized that he's related to Rosetta Nastasi.
Ah, really? So we put them in contact.
Yeah, so he just messaged Michio Catalano via Facebook.
Rosetta.
Solana, can you tell Rosetta Nastasi about Thomas Lamantia?
Silvana, tu Rosetta la incontri in chiesa?
Sì,
Silvana can call her and talk with Rosetta as well. Sì, c'è questo signore Lamantia, Thomas Lamantia, che sta venendo a Carlentini. E sono parenti.
Sono parenti di Rosetta?
Sì.
Sì.
Oh, if they're related with the Rosetta, they must be related with Mary Kay too.
Yes.
We're related to the Caniglia.
Ti posso scrivere subito su WhatsApp per Nuccio Catalano.
Sì.
Cosa gli devo dire che vi scrivo?
Do you remember Nick when Thomas is coming in Carlentini? It was August 3rd.
I'd have to look. I don't remember exactly.
I think they're going
to
be
It was August the 3rd, though.
The first week in August.
Is it?
Yeah.
Which one? I'm sorry, Mary Kay.
The first week in August, they're going to be there.
Allora, il primo weekend di agosto c'è questo signore che si chiama Thomas Lamantia che viene a Carlentini. Se Rosetta è disponibile.
Did you do any research in Termini about the Lamantias?
In Termini Merese, you mean, Dean?
Yes.
Lamantia are not just a Carlentini. I mean, Sicilian name, but it's not that popular in Carlentini, vero Silvana?
No, my great grandmother.
Carlentini c'è qualcuno. Yeah, c'è un cugino di mio marito che si chiama Amantia, non Lamantia, per esempio, di Lentino. Mm-hmm. Ah, certo, sono nomi che comunque provengono da altre città vicine.
Our names città. Coming from other cities, so yes.
Beh, però, ce ne sono, c'è qualcuno che si chiama.
Ok.
I put what he told me about his phone number. And he'll be in Rome July 29th through the 31st, and then in Sicily from August 1st through the 6th. He'll be
quindi dall'1 agosto al 6, e il suo numero di telefono è 402-250-2906.
Sì, l'ho visto
nella chat, non me lo so. Sì, se si vogliono sentire con Rosetta.
Ma come sono parenti? Cioè, qual è il fatto di parenti?
How are they related?
Ve lo dico.
Do you remember?
For me, they're related to me through the Caniglia line. I believe his mother was a Caniglia, or his grandmother.
Allora, sono legati adesso la linea dei Caniglia. Sua mamma o sua nonna doveva essere una Caniglia. E quindi sicuramente così come
Sebastiano è Anastasia.
Okay, so Rosetta, mother, her grandmother, her great grandmother Carmela Caniglia, her second great grandfather Cayetano Caniglia. Third great grandfather Rosario Caniglia. And then it starts going down to Thomas's
quindi
line.
Sua mamma si chiamava Caniglia.
Allora, la bisnonna di Rosetta, suo padre, era contemporaneamente papà di questa bisnonna e dell'antenato di Thomas. Quindi saranno cugini di quarto grado, soltanto che
la parente era un po' lontana.
Discendono di frate e soro, praticamente. From a sister and a brother.
Quindi questo era il figlio. Chi era?
So Carmela.
Il parente di.
I found several other relatives for Thomas, but we've been having trouble getting them connected.
Okay.
Gaetano Caniglia ha scritto Dean. Quindi questo Gaetano Caniglia era il bisnonno in comune di Rosario, di Thomas e Rosetta?
Sì.
Allora, Gaetano.
Ora te lo mando su screenshot, Silvana, aspetta.
I posted on the site Carlentini and see if I can find that.
Tieni, Joy. Te lo sto mandando ora.
Ok.
Io pure sono col cellulare, quindi viene un po' male.
Ma io sono col computer, stavo per fare la foto, però.
Sì.
Vabbè, l'importante è che si leggono meno.
Sì, sì.
Perfetto. Now, Scott is having trouble getting in, so I need to send him a... let's see. How was I going to find that?
Oggi c'è stato un incendio pericolosissimo a Carlentini. Ci sono bruciate quattro case. Sì, sì, ma dalla zona archeologica. Sai che ci sono tutte quelle case.
Torino Damaro and Maria Ira. And then I received responses from Enza Damaro. And apparently she's not related to those.
Enza Damaro. The hairdresser, and she's cousin of Carmelita. She has been my hairdresser since I was 8.
Ma anche di Meg non si può.
And Meg. Mm-hmm.
I forgot that she was the hairdresser, yeah.
Yeah.
But she's not actually a relative. It's not Meg. She knows.
We are talking about her cousin. Relatives. Okay. So do you think she's related with this guy?
No, what she told me was, okay, so Cornelia Rosario e Scroe Margarita avevano un solo figlio che era Cornelia Giuseppe che a sua volta ha avuto due figli.
Rosetta e Concettina Danina. E hanno abitato a Siracusa ed era una grande amica di mamma.
Di mia mamma Maria Ira.
Maria Ira.
So they were great.
Ah, questo l'ha scritto Enza. Questo l'ha scritto Enza di Mauro.
She's writing...
sì. Sono cresciute come sorelle loro, allora, scienza l'hanno vissuta a Carlentini. Ora sono morte tutte e due, di cui prima Concettina. E circa due anni fa.
Lucia Festival. And she's a professora.
Giussi Marchese al liceo.
Several times to contact her, but she never did it.
Like in the high school or at the elementary school?
I think at the university in Catania, because she lives over in one of the Etna towns.
No, dice che probabilmente è una professoressa all'università di Catania e vive in uno dei piccoli paesini etnei.
Ed è parente di Thomas?
Mm-mm.
Insegnante universitaria
si chiama
Ok. Di origine carlentinese, non l'ho mai sentito.
Abita verso Catania. She didn't say exactly where she works, but I just thought based on where she lived that she might work at the university.
She's so cute. She said, I asked to my mom because she met Rosario and Margarita Caniglia and some of the grandkids that were amazing, good people, good workers, and they had a pasta maker place. And I live close where they used to live. So I will send you a picture. And if you want their contact, just let me know. Very cute. Yeah, Enza, she's such a sweet person.
Anche Enza's father, che sua cugina, sono tutti parenti.
Sono carinissimi.
That's short for Lorenza.
Enza, yeah.
That's short for Lorenza.
Could be Lorenza or Vincenza.
Penso Vincenza.
Vincenza, vero?
Sì, perché da noi
Vincenza, no Lorenza. Their names are Vincenza and Lucia, but the two sisters, they work in the same hairdresser salon. So if you will come to Carlentini, they will be more than happy to be your hairdresser.
Lucianella.
And everybody, we call them Enza and Lucianella. And they have my sister's age kids. Enza has a son, Lucianella two boys, and the three of them, they're all in north of Italy, like Milan, Turin. The new generation is almost all gone. Ora una vita che I figli di Enza e Lucianella sono su al nord.
Nick, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Getting back to this Thomas Lamantia, his mother, Fanny Caniglia Lamantia?
Yes.
There's no Michaela in her name. I have her memorial service here. And there's no Michaela. She was just known as Fanny L. Is this a different person?
No, I think it just sort of dropped out of the lexicon because when I go to look at her birthday and let me just
okay
what I'm doing here. Find her. Mila. Amelia? Yeah. Okay. So, I mean, I could drop it out of the description because I know she didn't really use it in later life, but.
Yeah, because like I say, I have her memorial here. We went to the funeral and it's just Fanny. There's no Michaela.
Yeah.
So why do things drop off? Why would that drop off?
Do you think it has been Americanized?
Sometimes Michaela, the family just puts what they know on the funeral brochures. They don't think about genealogy. They just put how they knew her.
I thought I had her birth record attached, but it doesn't show here.
Dice c'era scritto Fanny nella tomba. Quindi probabilmente non hanno guardato manco il vero certificato del vero nome di sta signora.
I thought I had seen something in the Nebraska birth index for her.
23. Mm-hmm. She's, you know, they're also related to the Francos, so I don't know if their connection was Susan, because our kids went to school together, and I know the Francos, Lamantias, and my kids were all distant cousins.
I think number three might be it.
This one here, yeah.
Yeah, 23.
So there's 8th of May, 1923. It says she was the
right
daughter of Joseph.
Right. Daughter of Giuseppe and Lucia.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
that's her then.
This is 8th of March. So I don't know. There could be enough. I mean, I may have mistakenly conflated the two. I don't know.
Okay. Well, I was just curious because I talked to my sister about it after last week's meeting, and we just thought we'd never heard that name, Michaela, attached to her.
And the family wasn't, the kids weren't familiar with it. They may just have left it off the funeral brochure.
Okay.
My dad's cousin was Sam, but his real name was Concetto, but nobody knew that.
Okay.
There's no Fanny with a Y. And it's a broad search, so I'm pretty sure it would come up. So I think that was probably her birth record.
But, oh, okay.
When you go back and look at her in the early records, like 1930 would have been her first census.
There's no A in Michaela in the middle. Yeah, there.
Their middle names are different too, Lucia and Althea.
Yeah, and the date is different. So I don't know, maybe this isn't the right one, but I'm not coming up with a Cornelia.
Well, it's the right death.
Yeah, the death is right.
Yeah.
It's just, it's May instead of March. Oh, that's that one. What's that one, yeah.
That's a public record. So this is late in life.
But okay.
She was definitely Fanny by 1940.
Okay.
I don't know what her birth name actually was.
Okay.
Let's just do this. When you search, one alternative way of searching, if you're not real sure, just put in like the surname and the year.
Mm-hmm.
So we can see if there are any other Cornelias born in 1923. And
there's two.
In December, yeah. Luisa, 7 June 24. But I mean, it's interesting, the other.
Yeah,
put it down. Isn't showing up here either.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know what I think?
Is on the one that was born in December. If you click on that to see if it's a boy or a girl.
Well, the parents are wrong.
Oh, Sebastian. Okay. Well, you got Joseph there and a couple.
I'd move that born 1923 over towards the exact more. And they'll get rid of all the extras.
Good idea.
Okay, well, let's see.
There's Michaela.
Yeah. May 8th, right.
And so there's a Sebastiana. There's one that was born in December, and there was Torino that was born in October.
Mm-hmm.
So that to me was the closest Earth record.
So but, click on the view record if you would please for that.
Yeah.
And that was a female.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Hey Nick, why don't we just ask Tom?
Well, he'd never heard it either, so
I think
and I had this conversation.
Okay.
But that kind of makes sense, because Michaela,
Althea,
you would get Fanny out of that somehow.
Okay. Okay.
Well, Althea, I've seen Althea rendered as either Fina or Fanny.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
So,
like I say, my sister and I were talking about it. We never heard of that. So I just wanted to ask. My friend
Michaela was transferred to Madeline.
Because
that was my great grandmother's name, and all her female grandchildren were named Madeline. In my opinion, it's preferable to Fanny. That's just my opinion.
Yeah.
Editing in the wrong place here. Not sure where I got the Lucia, but I think it might have been from another family tree, but.
Kind of crazy, but another way you could check the birthday on here in her name is to, in the World Herald, they have like happy birthday announcements.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, and she is in the time frame there where if you look on May 8th and look her name up in there. This is like anywhere from, yeah, if you put in like 1930 or something like that, or, you know, something in the 30s. For a happy birthday for May 8th.
That's a big assumption.
In the past, in the newspaper, could you wish a happy birthday too? And they were like a public?
Well, it was children. It was school-age kids that they had a list of names of children. There she is, Fanny Caniglia. So that's the birthday. Usually, they got the school people on there.
How do you know those are about birthdays? It's just a bunch of names.
Well, if he would open that up, you would see the happy birthday at the top of the column.
And they did birthday greetings in there. In the newspaper, and
this is I think they have roll up just a little bit.
That's a lot.
This is a tea honoring schoolgirls, so it's not actually.
Okay, well, that isn't. Are you on? You're on May 3rd.
There's no way. So it's all people's birthdays on one day.
These are grade school, public school kids.
Public school kids? Dicevo, bambini delle scuole pubbliche.
Yeah, can
quindi di che stiamo un problema mettendo l'articolo sul giornale?
Sì, che in base a chi faceva il compleanno lo mettevano nel giornale quel giorno. Carina come cosa. Meglio che la gente è morta.
Come il necrologio.
You can't look specifically for May.
You can do what's called a browse. You can put the exact date in, actually. You can just put
that's
but it's going to come up
5/5/8.
If you, the problem, Jim, is you would have to put
check specific date.
You'd have to put the exact date, and you can only
search and that's
one
what
day.
I'm telling you. Her birthday, her birthday is May 8th.
Right. So if we say 1930, whoops.
I can actually see how easy it would be to, if someone looks at May and puts March instead of May, that's just one letter difference. It just might be a type error.
Mm-hmm. Is this looking through the World Herald?
Yeah, this is all Nebraska papers.
Well, okay. Let me go find my index here.
It's also a newspapers.com too, but.
Is the World Herald out there? Okay. This is specific for the World Herald. Because it's the World Herald program where they invite the kids down for the celebration at the Orpheum Theater.
It won't be like for 5, 10, something like that. Just 7 is kind of random.
No, this is all year long.
Right, but for everybody every kid that turns whatever.
Yeah, on their birthday. Let me find one here. You got my tree? Because I think if you look at my mom, because I think I placed, you know, something on there for my mom. One of those birthday announcements.
Okay, so Omaha World Herald. Obituaries.
Well, that's kind of late. 2005, the current.
That says obituaries.
There we go. This is the one we want. Okay, so now.
And put in May 8th, and then just type in happy birthday for the keywords.
What year?
1930 is fine. As long as she's a school age kid. But only one?
Yeah.
Doesn't look like a birthday.
May not have started quite that early.
Yeah, and go to like 35 or something.
Arco, I'm related to Arcos.
There's one right there.
Yeah. I'm related to the Arcos.
You know, I'd seen him before, but took a little bit of manipulation here. So yeah, they do this thing called the happy birthday call.
There
it is. Oh. Four grade school children in Omaha are celebrating their birthdays today.
There's Fanny is down there.
The World Herald.
Fanny went to Lincoln School.
Can you put Fanny it down there?
Age 7, Lincoln School.
Okay.
What's the date on that?
May 8th, 1930. Well, thanks, Jim, for being persistent. We got there.
Well, it looks like it's all school age kids, because Sacred Heart is a parochial school. St. Francis is a parochial school.
Mm-hmm. Era la scuola che si chiamava St. Francis qualcosa. Carina.
But she's listed as Fanny, not as Michaela.
Right. What it looks like there, you know, that's why
maybe it dropped already.
I think she became Fanny, you know, as soon as she was born, really.
Yeah, she probably didn't like Michaela.
Okay.
She didn't like Althea, so they came up with Fanny.
Okay. Thanks for solving the mystery.
Yeah, this is like where was Washington School at?
She was at Lincoln School.
There was a Washington School, and I don't think there's one in public schools today.
Okay, so
there is a Washington School. It's off of 50th and Leavenworth.
It's about 55th and like Mayberry, maybe, or Walnut. I think it's about 55th and Walnut Street.
Okay.
So I'm looking at the 55th and Mayberry. And in Michaela and Anthony had a child in 1966. So that was probably her legal name.
Michaela e Anthony hanno avuto il loro figlio nel 1966, quindi probabilmente questo era un nome di mezzo che le aveva Fanny. Is this school, this Washington school, still available, still open, still active?
Yes.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, 55th and Mayberry.
Questa scuola ancora è attiva dove andava lei.
So that's out there by Elmwood Park. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So see, what else is going on? So one of the things that I've been chatting with this Debbie Nuno, and then Carmelita joined the conversation, and they had queens. You know, I've been working on the queens, the past queens for Santa Lucia, and we also had queens for the Sons of Italy, apparently, because Carmelita was, and that Debbie Nuno was. So that's been it. And then just go back here. Sorry. Yeah, as far as drawing certain things like the pedigree charts and that, but so Marianne, you and I have been chatting about a walking tour on Pierce Street.
Yes.
I sent you some stuff today. I don't know if you got a chance to look at it, but there were several pages out of that South Omaha booklet, which mentioned Pierce Street. And,
okay.
And also mentions Salerno quite a bit.
Okay.
Which is this booklet, Nick?
So let me bring it up.
The South Italians of Omaha book, you mean?
Yeah, it's called South Omaha, something or other.
South Omaha. I will have a breakfast with Marianne in the next days.
Their Omaha history articles.
I was wondering.
Omaha awareness tours near South Side. So now.
I'm wondering if there are books.
I shared it with people at one point, but.
Where are you sharing in our chat?
Let me show you the book. We have it up now. Okay, so this is the cover, and so Marianne, you've been talking about Nancy Augusta. She's mentioned in the credits.
Can you go back? Okay. Oops.
Omaha awareness tours near South Side. And it was from 1979.
I have that book. I have that pamphlet.
And I got a really, well, this isn't a good one.
Why is it a black and white? Is it
I just photocopied it off. I've got, let's see if I can find it.
You got the wrong one.
Is it thick? Can you scan it if it's thin?
It's not very thick. I think it's only about maybe 7 pages.
I have a better copy here. Hang on.
Okay, let's see.
Are you in Chicago or in Florida?
I just came back from Florida. Here for a few days, then going to Omaha. Awesome.
So one of the things you can do with a PDF is you can search by a keyword.
So we can find it online, isn't it? For free?
Nancy D. Augusta has the copies. Because she sent this to me like some years ago.
Wasn't there a map?
Because she used to do this tour.
Like a map? Yeah, there's a map.
I will show them.
This is the map.
Here it is.
So that's all Little Italy.
Yeah.
One,
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I can bring this book when I come to Omaha. I've got it.
I have digital copies for anybody who wants it.
I do.
The numbers look like an index for whatever is in those places.
Right. So
yeah.
Number one is probably the same.
Okay, so there's the Durham, that's number.
Good job, Bob. Ah, che bello. This is exactly what I was asking yesterday to Sherry. I was like, hey, I have a breakfast with Marianne. Do you have perchance a place where I can find a book that talks about all the stops that we should have in Little Italy, a walking tour? And she was like, Marianne might know. I'm sure there are places. And here there is the book.
But some do not exist today, though. You know, some of them have been changed and all. Some are not there. But, you know, it's a good starting point.
Is this building still around at Christ Child Center?
Yes.
It's changed quite a bit.
The White House apartment is still there, right next it's door.
It's on the corner.
Right.
The new building is where that is.
Mm-hmm. I thought it was interesting, this comment here, that they said that the Christ Child Center was first located at 6th and Pierce on the top floor of Salerno's Grocery, and later at 7th and William.
Can we, for example, I don't know if we are allowed to, I should talk with Todd. If we make enough copy, why don't we organize a little table during Santa Lucia of things that people can take, leaving a little donation that can be used for whatever?
That would be perfect. Yeah. We would love to have that.
They're gone. Bohemian Cafe is gone.
Eleanor, if you go back down, there was that Buddha's grocery store. That's the one that I was telling you about.
Yeah, for copyright laws.
He made the best of Zita.
There. The building's still there.
Yeah, so he was a sweetheart.
If you want the best of Zita, you have to go to Mary's house and ask her father to make it for you.
All right.
I'm with my dad on Sundays. Buddha's.
Yeah, Al was a great guy. Our florist was across the street in Over on 13th and Martha.
Bello.
I'm not familiar with the history book or history booth down there, but would they have stuff like this in the history booth?
No, she might have something, but I'm not quite sure if this is there for like copies to take for people. So, we have a meeting tomorrow night. Eleanor, are you coming to that meeting?
Yes.
Okay.
We are preparing. Sherry bought a lot of nice things. What were you saying?
There are prayer cards, but we're running out of them.
Prayer cards.
Oh, no, we have plenty of prayer cards upstairs, Sherry. Trust me.
I'll show you what she's doing.
Marianne, yes. This, I think, number 39 is kind of interesting to me, Little Frank's Restaurant. Before becoming a restaurant owned by Mr. and Mrs. Frank Davila, the lot held a string of wood two-story apartments called Salerno Flats.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think this actually exists anymore, this building. But that corner, the southwest corner of...
Yeah.
Southwest corner.
It was on the other side of the tracks, across from Ortsy's, on the other side, Nick.
When you cover it like this, it has to be round.
Make it round.
Yep.
That's the building that they used to board all of the newcomers into town.
Right.
I'll do it. Take it.
And he mentions that again. Here, or they mention it. I think Nancy DiAgosta was one of the authors of this. The first Italians to move this area Joseph Larino came in 1895, and he owned a grocery store and a string of apartments called Salerno Flats on 6th and 7th mm-hmm. Streets. So,
isn't that where Orsi's is?
A little less specific about the location there.
On the other side of the tracks, Dean. You know, on our other side.
This is a block west of Orsi.
Right, a block west of Orsi, that's right.
And this is
what that restaurant looked like at that time. Now it's a concrete cutting warehouse type building.
Mm-hmm.
Salerno's groceries was actually at 6th and Pierce, according to this.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yes.
Ryan Gemelli's barbershop was still in that vicinity as well.
That's Train School.
Yeah, a lot of you talk about Train School.
That was, well, it's a couple of blocks down the street from, or up the street from Little Italy. A lot of kids went to school there.
My mom taught there, Nick.
Really?
Yeah.
There was, I met somebody who actually went to school there.
The festival had one time had purchased that building with the help of Alfie Cascio. I don't know when they sold it or whatever. So when you come, Nick, there's a gentleman, Dave Hillpiper, who was president of the festival for a long time. He has a lot of history. He can fill you in on some of the other stuff of the festival and Train School and things in the area as well.
I went to kindergarten there.
Jim and I were talking about Dolman Park the other day.
That was, that's down in my neighborhood, this film number 51.
I like those two positions. Mm-hmm. Whatever they share in your own.
This is an interesting little book. It's, you got to kind of, like Marianne was saying, a lot of this stuff is gone, so you got to kind of use your imagination. But
yeah,
the number of groceries is always amazes me, because they mentioned Piccolo's
buildings. A lot of the buildings are still there.
And then the Piccolo's is the one that is now the Bella Vita.
Uh-huh. A lot of people lived behind their store, Nick. It was sort of their house
mm-hmm.
in those days.
Yeah. My uncle's had a grocery store for a couple of years, but there was another one like three blocks away.
Yeah, you know, you had Joe Castro's grocery there on 5th and Williams. Actually, that was 6th and William. And then two blocks east of there was Bosco. And then I think, then you had Salerno. That was, you know, everything was within like, a block or so.
Now, Mike.
Not very far to get to the grocery store.
Yeah, my grandfather's store was what was a little further west.
Dad.
So, Manganaro's drugstore, is that what you're talking about, Gene?
It was my father's uncle. I'm not sure.
What's number 70?
Talking.
There's
Turco's shop is number 70, Pierce Street between 5th and 6th.
Somehow I got muted, people. So sorry, I had to.
Side. The Turco.
Any relation to you?
The Mary Turco Kay? Family. Louis,
Nick, what's,
Joe,
a, what's the name of that book?
It's Nick, called Omaha Awareness Tours.
Tours, right. The Near South Side.
Beautiful.
There was, some Turcos had a car lot, so maybe it was them.
Well, this says they were race car builders in the 1930s.
Okay. It's Donna, Di Stefano, Aletta. Every corner talks Carlentinese there.
You guys know the spare time? Was that?
It was a very good restaurant. Very good restaurant.
What?
My uncle used to work for Sam Neill.
Was that on the other side of the tracks down there on Pierce?
It's on the southeast side. It's just a lot now. It's
so 12 is what? That's Pacific Street?
Yeah.
One block south of Pacific.
Yeah, you can see it's all torn down. It's just a lot. I think the sign might be, I'm not sure it's still there. That's cool. That's really cool.
If we make copies of that, we
can sell this.
Yeah, can even just a little donation, maybe printed in a nice way. Is that a thick book, 70 pages? You said
no, so? No, seven. No, it's not thick at all. There,
seven.
Right there.
Oh, okay, it's only
20 pages.
Well, maybe
it's 20
maybe
pages.
20?
20, yeah. Here's the count of pages. We're on page 17.
I just stuck a digital download for that thing on the chat.
Oh, good.
Vediamo.
This is a great image. I love this one. This is the one they used for a t-shirt, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's beautiful. It's true. Dice, questa foto la potrei usare per una maglietta. È bellissima.
Lo sentino, Italia è bello.
Eh sì.
The little boy in that picture, that's my dad.
Really? Dice, il ragazzino in questa foto, là accanto al... Lo vedi il ragazzino, Silvano,
sì,
vicino
sì.
alla batteria? Quello lì è il papà di Mary Ann.
My grandfather, my nanu is right behind him to the left.
The one with the big mustacho?
No. The one next to him.
The other one.
Quello
suo nonno. Okay. Ti immagini.
Here are the credits of who worked on this project, and Nancy Dick Challenger was the principal investigator.
Mm-hmm.
She was in charge of
D'Agosta,
taking people on the tour, and this is what she used.
Well, don't we increment this little booklet with the other one of the Omaha with nice, beautiful pictures?
That's what she gave me. That's the workshop.
My God, that's a Sherry's cousin. She said, telling her family history. Wow, that's a lot of work. The D'Agosta family.
I think, okay, so digital commons. Okay, so I'm gonna pull that up.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That one. And?
So you can actually, using that link that Monica put in the chat, you can actually download a copy of your own.
You want something to drink out?
Some water.
Ice water?
Thank you. It is.
Yeah, it came out. That's a good call. I got it.
Those of you who are interested in downloading it, you should open that window or copy the link before the chat closes.
Okay.
Can I scan it? Can I scan them and take them virtually? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yep, we can do that. I'll
do them. The director of the book that we just saw is Sherry's cousin. And Sherry, she just gave me two huge folders that are the researches that she has done with her family, because Sherry is part of
Shishilo and Brogna.
So it's like thick like my face, you see? So it goes forever, all the info of the family tree. And there's another folder with a lot of beautiful pictures that I'm going to scan, and maybe we can share them in the group.
Are Sherry related to Nancy?
I just said Shishulo and Brogna.
Shishulo and Brogna.
Her mother and my great grandmother were cousins.
Okay.
But they've stayed in touch with
us. I'm sure you recognize a lot of those people.
Udo, Monaco.
Well, but.
Tribulato.
Tribulato, Monaco. Are just a lot of family pictures. A lot of family pictures. And then there is a fighter. I think it was a. What was he called?
Boxer.
Nino Di Augusta.
Boxer.
Huh?
Nino Di Augusta.
He had a bar on Grover Street.
Interesting.
That's Nancy's brother.
She was a boxer.
Great job.
Yeah. You want to meet her? I got to bring something to her today.
And also my cousin, too.
Yeah. It's Donna's cousin before my cousin.
Correct. Because Donna is first cousin with your mom. Interesting. Well, we're all connected.
Yeah, so that's the kind of stuff that I'm looking for people to bring to put on display at the tables in the front. Mm-hmm. So if you got stuff like that, that'd be great. If you want to make something up, that'd be great.
Okay, Sherry said, in Sicily, we have shops where we can easily go and they can copy. I will scan them and then send them, so you can print them if I'm allowed to do it, or just put those in our desks. It's already ready. So people, they can open them and consult them and maybe take inspiration how to make a different kind of family tree. Even Sue and Bob's books are beautiful. So everybody at one point has his own style. Let's say, that's different.
So what's your plan, Eleonora? Are you just taking it one day at a time, or do you have a grand
I'm pretty going like that, because seeing that it wasn't that easy to come here, it took 36 hours, and now the airport of Palermo is closed because of another fire. This is ridiculous, but anyway, I'm really glad that I'm here. I haven't stuck my calendar in a tight way. I still have a lot of days off, pretty empty, a lot of lunch and dinners. I'm staying at Sherry's mother's house at the lake, where there are thousands of pictures made since the 60s till nowadays. A lot of them are made in Carlentini, so sometimes I have fun just relaxing, looking at the water out of the lake, and watch those all the pictures. And then I'll have some activities in the meanwhile. For example, we had a brunch the 24th, some of us that are here today, where we were together 2 days ago. I will meet people one by one, above all those that are involved in projects. I will be part of the Santa Lucia Festival Committee for the reunion to help and organize. The 27th, I will be the whole day at the Metropolitan Culinary College making pizza with the kids. August 12th, I will be a sommelier in Mike Di Giacomo and Dominic's restaurant. and Sips, the new restaurant that they just opened. And then the
day is that? What day?
The August 12th. They're promoting it. I just changed some wine 2 days ago, so they were ready to go, and I made the last change. So they were like, oh, I'm sorry. So they will promote it soon, sharing how many wines, which kind of wines. So it's going to be 5 wines, 5 dishes pairing. And then August 18th, it will be my birthday. So I'm working on a list of people that I would like to invite. I would like to have everybody. So I am planning to do it at Mike Di Giacomo's restaurant, so I can go as high as 150 people. I think I don't know so many people in Omaha, so I will try to do not forget the people around. So that's the plan. It's going to be a beautiful month. There is the festival in the meanwhile. You're coming too. So I'm so glad that I'm here, that I made it. I'm helping Sherry. Here is flowers and roses everywhere, preparing the crowns. They're beautiful. I'll show you something. That's what she made. Aren't they cute, huh?
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Every year they will be different. Vedi Silvano, ogni anno fanno queste coroncine che poi possono indossare le varie reginette. And then she made this beautiful bouquet for the queen. She just finished it. So I'm helping with the design, let's say. And she put a little Santa Lucia here. Silvana, se per caso da noi ci sono queste medagliette così, sai dove si possono comprare?
Non lo so, quello non lo so. Sto vedendo qua in internet, gliel'ho mandata adesso a Sherry, che c'è una medaglietta simpatica.
Sì. We would like to buy mandata. More like that.
Mm-hmm. Non lo so, quello lo potremmo chiedere a in chiesa, infatti ora io lo chiederò in chiesa a qualcuno.
Yep.
Okay. Però penso che c'è qualcuno anche che le fa.
Sì, it must be at some company making them, you're right. Va bene. So that's my plan. Relax, stay with friends, plant new seeds. I will meet the mayor, and I'm combining a meeting between Mayor Stottard and Mayor Steffio online when I will be there, because we have to move forward with the ceremony for the sister city, the sister city final ceremony that will be next year. So a lot of important things.
I just wanted to talk briefly about the plan for the genealogy room. I have several folks lined up to be consultants, and just want to make sure everybody's okay with the plan. So this email went to Jim, Dean, Mary Kay, Nick Gibilisco, and Gary Gibilisco. So as you all know, we're going to be there Saturday and Sunday from noon to 5. Monica's unable to join us due to her childcare responsibilities, but we'll have myself, 6 consultants. So Mary Kay came up with this brilliant idea to use pedigree charts as a way to orient ourselves as to who these people are. And so we're going to use a blank pedigree chart or family tree, for those of you who prefer that language. And
on a chart.
I'm going to receive the guests as they come through the door and make a quick survey of their needs. I'm going to write their name and the home position on the pedigree chart and note their email, address, and phone number on the chart. I'll ask them what documents they have in hand and ask them if they already have an online tree. I know I've talked to several people who I know are already in the tree that I have, which is called Italians of Omaha. So if they are there, I will make note of that fact that they are already in the Italians of Omaha tree. And once I got enough information, I'm going to hand them off to one of the consultants, take a snapshot of their tree before they go. So maybe Kay and Dean will be working primarily on Lentini, but depending on, you know, the flow, if Gary and Jim are going to work primarily on Carlentini, and depending on flow, we might have to change that around a bit, but that's the plan for now. I was trying to get a sense of how people are going to research and record the information. So Jim, let's start with you. How would you approach that in terms of researching and recording the information?
Well, depending on what they have, you know, well, you know, I could, what I did last year was start a tree with what we knew, you know, out on ancestry.com with their name, you know, their family name or whatever. And
okay, so you made a unique tree for each individual then?
Yep. Yeah. Well, there wasn't that many.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we even had one there, you know, the one couple that came in where his ancestry was from Sweden. And, you know, whatever. So.
You worked on that too, huh?
Yeah, those are always fun. You know, you learn a new language.
There you go. Okay, so Gary G, are you with us still?
He lost. He was sick.
Hey, Nick. Yeah. I have a very basic question.
Yes.
What is the goal or the purpose of this? Are we trying to create something for them? Create something for your major tree? What is the purpose?
Both. I think principally it's just to kind of get them fired up about genealogy and searching their roots. The reason I'm going to take a picture of, you know, the little pedigree chart that I get some initial information from them is I'm going to copy that with my phone, because at some point, depending on the availability of my time, I would contact them with a follow-up and say, you know, are you interested in doing this further? And then I would add their information to the Italians of Omaha tree with their permission. So, I mean, and the other thing, I think it's just kind of to help people realize that we're all one big happy family, and you know, that we're just here having fun. And so that's my purpose.
I'd like to share something too. Recently, through some of my distant Coniglia relatives, I was given an online picture of my grandfather when he was young. It was a 1910 photo, and I think I sent it to you, Nick. It's just an amazing photo. So if anyone has any photos, it would be nice to at least take a picture of them and keep them as reference resources, because they are quite difficult to come across. But when you do come across one, it's amazing. It's just, it tells a story. Is there any way you could pull that up and share it? I don't know, where did I send it to you in an email?
Yeah, I'd have to do some searching to find it. But Connie raises a really good point. People last year brought in documents, you know, like passports, and you know, they had an image of the person on the passport. So, you know, we were able to capture those digital images and add those to the Italians of Omaha tree. And kind of my rule of thumb is make sure that you frame it so that you get the whole thing in. Don't try to crop it down real close, because sometimes there's information on the margins, or sometimes like old photographs have the name of the photographer or the name of the city on them. So you want to get the front, and then you also want to get the back, because sometimes there's writing on the back and also the name of the photographer sometimes can be on the back and the city where it was taken. So that's important as well. And the other thing that you can do is, you know, as you're talking to the person, if there's nothing written on it, just pull out a sheet of paper and write down what the person tells you. And then also, as you're taking the picture, you know, take the front, take the back, plus take picture of what the person told you.
I guess that's one of the reasons I asked the purpose is, are we trying to gather information? Are we trying to give them information, do a little research, and have something for them? If so, what is that? Because most of them aren't going to bring a flash drive or a computer. So, right. and we don't have a printer.
That's why I was thinking email addresses. And, you know, then we could, if they've not digitized their own pictures, we can email them the digital images. We can email them what we find, you know, whatever we can scratch out on that little pedigree chart for them. We can give them the before and then the after.
If I came, I would want something in return. If I'm going to a genealogy room, I'm hoping to get something when I leave that I have more than I came with.
Right. That's exactly right. So, we definitely need to deliver.
Mm-hmm. Can I say
something? It might take some time to do that. You can't expect it right there instantaneously.
Thank you, Sheila, for highlighting this point, because it's very important to know where we are going and the reason why we are doing things. Sometimes we don't ask ourselves that much. We just do that because we love it and that's it. But I think that looking at this thing with a bigger point of view, I think we are the only ones who are so active in helping people mostly for free. And we are creating something that I've never seen somewhere else, and give to our genealogical group recognition during such an important festival like Santa Lucia means that people coming, they can go in a place that will reconnect them with their culture, with their ancestors, with their homeland, because the majority of them coming at that festival, they have Italian origins. And on the other side, what's going on in Carlentini is that a lot of people, they are asking for dual citizenships, paperwork. So Lucy Latina was sharing with me 2 days ago. She said, I've never seen so many people asking the process in Carlentini to obtain dual citizenships, like in the last years since you have started the Sister City project. So that means that Carlentini could be cut because it's a small city and the office and the city hall, they work very well, could be an excellent choice for people who wants to obtain this goal. And this is part of a bigger drawing that is changing people's lives, because when they will get their dual citizenships, so they can decide eventually to come to Italy to live, or to let their kids come to Italy to study. And everything starts with a little first step. And that little first step goes through, which was your mom's and dad's date of birth and death, which are your grandparents. So this first question opens a world. Building the family tree is the pillar to start building a bridge that will connect those people on the other side. So that's the most important part. We are helping to make this connection stronger. Plus, you and I and a lot of people here, we have been since the really beginning around. If someone comes to me asking me, Eleonora, can you help me with the genealogical researches? Even if I've done 2 hours per week, I don't know how many hours a year they are. So I don't know in 5 or 4 years, how many hours of genealogy we have done. I couldn't start from zero. I cannot help a person. I don't have the eye that Nick has or Dean or Jim. So you must have a technique, experience, you know where to put your hands because you can easily make mistakes, are very delicate things. So to let people having access to their skills so easily means to give them the possibility to change their life in an easier way, because that's their dream. Maybe one day I will have a little desk in a corner saying, do you want to come to Italy? Ask me how to have your travel, ask me to design your itinerary, because those are our skills. So I'm very proud of what you're doing. And who knows, maybe in the future, if some young person is interested in learning this, we can create new employment. Because if we have the demand and we have the offer, we can grow all together.
Can I interject here? Mm-hmm. I like a lot of the things that you've said, Eleonora, and you, Nivia. Maybe we could have you talked about something that could take away. Maybe we could have a sheet that said, if you're thinking of dual citizenship, here's who you can contact. It'd be Nick Gibalisco. If you'd mm-hmm. like to visit Sicily, here's Eleonora's tour information, how to contact her. Here's how, here's a web link to you, Nick, to join our group. Here's how you can start a tree on Ancestry so they would know how to sign in for nothing, because a lot of these people don't want to pay for things.
Yeah.
So maybe you just had a guide sheet that they could leave with mm-hmm. with all these contact information.
That's exactly what I was going to say too, Bob. I think that's a great idea, because I agreed with Dean. You know, you can't promise them anything, but if they have something to take away, it'll get them thinking about a group and maybe show some interest in that. Because if you're going there, you want something in return, and having this sheet is a stepping stone to taking it further.
And the biggest thing that will be in return is the connection, right? Because when you build a stronger network of connections, so you won't have any surprise. So if you want to come to Sicily and you know zero people, you will never have the same experience as if you come and in 24 hours you have Silvana inviting you in her house, me taking you around, going inside of the mayor's office, or just knocking the doors and sneaking inside the people's homes. They will open their doors if they recognize familiar faces. So having the right connection in the right place makes a huge difference, and we are creating connections. So that's the main goal. Maybe those people, they know nobody and they don't know from where they have to start. And here we are, just to try to help them.
And I think in addition to that, I mean, if I went not having done anything, I would like the connection info for when I had time to focus on those things. But I would also like my own copy of that, I want to call it the paper tree, document Mary Kay is copying?
Your research?
The pedigree chart. I would like my own copy of a pedigree chart for as far as we got started. That would mm-hmm. be personal to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's true.
Let me interject or something. This is Scott. As an attorney who went through and did get Italian citizenship, one of the things that you do have to let people know on the very front end is citizenship is not open to everyone. The key is the person who came from Sicily, to the United States, did they have their family or did they start their family, your tree, before they became a U.S. citizen? Years ago, you had to renounce Italian citizenship when you became a U.S. citizen, and that closes the line. So people need to find out that. So with all the information you're giving them, let them, and if they say, I am interested in becoming an Italian citizen, the next key step is, did your grandfather give birth to your father after he became a U.S. citizen or before?
Before.
Because that closes, yeah. Because if they become a U.S. citizen before the person is born, that path is closed. You do not have citizenship available.
That is an excellent point, because I had that conversation at lunch yesterday with someone who was sure they could get dual citizenship until I pointed that out, Scott. And then they went,
That's a lot of work for people to go through to find out. No, I'm sorry, it's closed.
It's a privilege. It's not so for everybody. Yeah. It's true.
No.
Sta parlando Eleonora.
E non lo conosco, era un che si chiama Scott, che fa parte di una...
Scott, sì. È mio cugino. Solo che non si può collegare.
Lui diceva che è importante sottolineare il fatto che comunque l'avere la doppia cittadinanza non è una cosa che possono avere tutti. Quindi tramite le ricerche genealogiche possono rendersi conto se possono applicare o meno a questa richiesta.
The only thing I would add is you're providing a lot of good information for someone. I mean, I did not know my family tree. I did not know the extent of it until I went through that process, because you learn all about your grandparents and you learn all about your family and where they come from. So even if the citizenship aspect is closed, what you're providing with respect to a family tree is wonderful for the family. Because I've shared it with my brothers, my nieces, my nephews. I mean, it is magic, and it's keeping my grandparents' footprints and everything else alive. And if they're fortunate enough to pass or to get citizenship, you're continuing that to the next generation, because my children automatically have dual citizenship. So you're providing an awful lot of value, but do let them know that citizenship approach may not be open, and this is how you check. That's it. That's the only input I have. But it's a lot of value what you bring into the table.
Yeah, it's true. For example, in those days, Sherry, she's going through the process of keep going with her papers. And we were just talking about that yesterday, that now the embassy gives the appointment in 5 years.
6 to 8.
6 to 8. I'm sorry, minimum 5 years, but usually it's from 6 to 8 years just to have an appointment. So it's becoming a long process in the United States.
In 2019, Nick Jablisco did it in 6 months.
And in 2019, Nick Jablisco did it in 6 months. And now we need more than 6 years.
Yeah, it also depends upon where you apply. If you're in, for example, I'm using these examples, Boston, New York City, Omaha, where there's a lot of people of Italian descent, there is a lot of demand for the small spots. But there's other cities where there's not a very big Italian population. So get an appointment with that local embassy is not as bad.
Like Boston?
Boston has a very big... I think Houston is easier.
Houston?
So what I heard is we wanted to go to Boston because it's close to Maine where we are now, but we were told if we have our permanent residence is in New Mexico, we have to go to LA. We can't go anywhere.
That's correct. You cannot form shop. You have to go to the embassy that serves your place of residence, where you live. And for some people, they're very close. For other people, it's two states away.
Omaha is Chicago. See.
Can you research on ancestry, or how do you do that?
What's that to figure out?
There's a site out there that talks about Italian dual citizenship.
But to research
you could go right to
when they specifically became naturalized, Is that something you do on Ancestry?
No, not Ancestry.
You have to get those. You have to get those papers from the United States Citizenship and Immigration Service.
Yes. And you could find out without getting the official documents. You can find out when your lineage became a U.S. citizen. You know, so for me, I found out it was 1952. My dad was born in 1932. So that means the path was open, so I could spend the money and gather all the documents. So giving direction, like Nick just mentioned, to where you would go to search just to see that avenue, if that avenue is open, I think is a lot of value. Ancestry doesn't give that. You have to go to the U.S. immigration and naturalization.
Yeah, in Omaha, the Douglas County Historical Society has a lot of registers that can be helpful. Yesterday with Sherry, we went to Lincoln to get some apostille and bird certificates. So every place is different. What I can say is that in Carlentini, there are people asking for the process of dual citizenship. Obviously, we have to be, let's say, not allowed. One of our ancestors has to be Italian before becoming American, as Scott was saying earlier. So we must be part of that little percentage who are allowed to ask for dual citizenship. And if we are part of that, we can move to Italy. We have to move the residence. We have to rent a place. We have to open a bank account. We have to open a social security number. And there is a process through which in 6 years up to a year, up to 12, I'm sorry, 6 months up to 12 months, we can work on and obtain the dual citizenship. But because Carlentini is a city with less than 20,000 people, that's another option, another requirement, let's say. And because even if it's small, the office works very well. Lentini is not that organized as we know. So Lentini is cut out from this idea. It is not, cannot be used as a city to do that.
If you or Dean want just to kind of get an idea of all the things that would occur, just so you're comfortable with the process, you could call me. I'll be more than happy to walk you through it because I did it 4 years ago. It is not hard. The local consulate, you could go to the website and look at citizenship, and they also spell it out. It is much harder when you read through it than when it's simply explained. But I'll be more than happy to explain that to you or walk you through the process if that's anything that you want to, you know, consult on. So that was it. That's all I have to add. It is, it's a wonderful process if you qualify, and for you, for your family, for, you know, to maintain those roots. And even if it's not, you learn so much about your history and so much about your family.
I think it's important to let people know sort of a range of cost before they start into that to apply for if they're thinking it's going to be or minimal, they'll be in for a surprise. So I think they need to have an idea what this costs. Sure.
It depends.
Some of that depends upon how many generations they go back, but the whole process cost me less than $2,000.
Less than $2,000.
Well, that depends.
That included the 330 euros when I went to my appointment.
Through paternal, possibly, but if you go through the maternal, I think it's a lot more money than that.
Yeah. Well, if you go through maternal, and it's a 1948 case, it is more than that, because then you have to petition the court. You have to hire an Italian attorney. But if you're going through the paternal side, it is much easier, because all you're getting is birth certificates, marriage licenses, death certificates, your father's birth certificate, your mom's marriage license, your birth certificate, and all they do is just trace it down and, you know, when did
This is, for example, a list that they can easily ask for those certificates. So let's say for a minimum of $800 up, if you have your mother's side, is going to be minimum $2,000 up minimum. But people, they can easily spend even... I knew even people in Tuscany, north of Italy, there are companies asking to do all the process and everything. They paid even $5,000, $10,000. It depends.
Yeah. It's very, if you hire someone to do all the work, it could be $5,000 and up. If you do the work yourself, because all you're getting is notarized and apostille birth certificates, notarized and apostilled marriage license, and apostilled death certificates, and then having them translated into an Italian. Depends on, one, how many generations you go back and how many documents. Some states, apostille and notarized documents are $20. Other states, it's $100 per document. So it depends on where you live, but a good range is, because it's 330 euros just to sit down at the embassy. For your interview. So you figure $1,500 to $2,000 if you do the work yourself. And if you have to hire someone, it's going to be, you know, $3,000 to
$5,000.
Dipende da quanto costa ottenere la doppia cittadinanza. Lui dice, dipende già solo per sederti davanti al console per parlare in ambasciata, costa $360 o euro. No, dollari. Poi se vai attraverso la linea paterna, che è più facile, di solito con circa $800 riescono a sbrigare tutto, perché comunque si richiede una papella di documenti, ognuno costa, per esempio nel Nebraska costano $10, in altri stati costa $30, in altri $100 per ottenere ogni documento. E ci sono persone che invece attraverso la linea materna invece pagano anche fino a 4, 5, 6 mila dollari, anche a 10 possono arrivare se devono fare tante traduzioni certificate, ad esempio, o se ingaggiano qualcuno per fare il lavoro al posto loro. Quindi è un'esperienza che comunque come minimo costa $300 per sederti là davanti, 360, ma senza documenti non vai da nessuna parte. Quindi partiamo da una media minima di $800 fino al massimo di 10.000. Eh sì, per ottenere la doppia cittadinanza sì. Scusa, ho sentito una addirittura.
Io ho detto.
Okay. Nick, I'm assuming we have Nick Gibalisco there, right?
Yeah, Nick Gibalisco is a very honest, humble, excellent person who knows what to do. He's not expensive like other people that I met along the way, because as a translator, I've talked with several people. I know other translators in different companies. There is, for example, one in Ragusa, where I live, that is called Rosso Passaporto. They work a lot with Brazilian. They can easily start with 5,000. They don't let you sit if, I mean, this is the amount that they ask just to welcome you in their office. So it is not that expensive. It's quite less than this. And we are very happy that we have this guy who knows a guy in our crew. Because his company is called I Know a Guy, so that's why I'm just playing with this. For those who are not familiar, that's why we're lucky, because we got connections.
Connie had mentioned something earlier, and I'm going to see if this is the image. Are you there, Connie?
Please.
Was this the picture you were talking about?
Yes, Annie? It is. This is the picture I was talking about. And then I sent you one on your Facebook Messenger just now. It's a colorized version. But yes, the man sitting down to the right is my grandfather, Frank Tribulato. This picture was taken in Sicily. It was taken in Sicily.
I saw this picture already before.
It's the little boy on the left is one of the Coniglias who had to stay in Sicily because he had an eye infection. And they didn't allow people to come over with if they had conjunctivitis, eye infections, because there were no antibiotics in those days to clear it up quickly.
And when you go in Ellis Island, there is a section where you are at the medical control. They had a strange hook that was a special instrument that is lighted because it was one of the most important selection that they used to open the eye and see if there was that special illness that you're talking about. And eventually people, they were sent back straight home. Mm-hmm. So and they invented an instrument to double check this illness. That was not a conjunctivite, era un'altra. Now I'm not remembering. I recorded it when I was in Ellis Island. I'm not sure.
Blefarite?
Cosa?
Blefarite.
E potrebbe essere, in inglese era diverso, quindi c'era questo uncino a Ellis Island che ti apriva la palpebra e ti faceva vedere dentro come era combinato l'occhio, se erano malati li spedivano indietro perché non avevano antibiotici, non avevano i medicinali per quella specifica malattia. Dice che quel bambino a sinistra è stato rimandato indietro, infatti vedo che ha l'occhio un po' malandato. Through the picture, we can see that the left eye of this guy, of the baby, is like is not that good. It has some illness or something. The baby on the left has something in his eye. I don't know if it's related to this thing.
Yes, that's why his family came to the United States, and he was the oldest son, but he did not come with them. He had to stay back with his grandparents.
E allora questo bambino è dovuto ritornare indietro e è rimasto in Sicilia con i suoi nonni.
He come later? Was he able to come later?
He sure did. Yes, he did.
Ah, e poi ci è andato dopo, nel futuro. Okay, he didn't give up. Good.
So one of the things that webinar that I watched this week talked about reading fiction to get a feel for what it was like. And my wife's been reading this book called The Next Ship Home. And it's about a young Italian woman who arrives on the shores of America and sets her sight on a better life. But she finds that Ellis Island isn't a refuge. Not when ships depart every day with those who are refused entry to the country and when corruption ripples through every corridor. Well, of course, it's, you know, over-dramatizing perhaps to a degree, but there is some very serious part of the story as we're learning from this picture that beautiful. Some people had to stay behind or were sent home. And, yeah. That's interesting that this is all coming.
Dice Nico che questo libro che ci ha appena mostrato è una novella un po' romanzata che però racconta le storie di queste persone che sono dovute poi ritornare a casa e sono rimaste indietro e mette in luce proprio questi episodi. Molto interessante.
Nick?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. This is Kim. I was reading something. Can you still hear me? My computer.
Yeah, we hear you.
Weird on me. Okay, I was reading something written by a doctor in the New York area, whose family came over and from Italy. He said that everybody didn't go to Ellis Island. Those who were able to pay to have rooms, private rooms, those who had the money, they were taken and released in Manhattan Island.
That sounds right, because you know there was the first class passengers,
yes,
and the second class passengers that, yes, didn't have to go to Ellis Island, but it was the steerage passengers that had to go to Ellis Island.
Yes, that it was the steerage passengers. And he also said, and this really, really upset me, and it may be why, you know, I'm glad that my grandmother was such a fabulous, you know, cook. And, you know, and that was where we were always shown so much love. You know, special events, us kids love stuffed artichokes. And by gosh, she'd have a stuffed artichoke for every single person, your own stuffed artichoke. But their food in those who had first and second class, they were fed meals that you could determine what it was on the plate. Everything then was thrown together and made like a gruel or slop, actually. And that was all mixed up, and they were served that into bowls. And that's what steerage got to consume. So just really sad. Just, it was really heartbreaking. And they painted the picture of the journey, the babies, no place to, you know, they didn't have disposable diapers. And by the time the picture was painted, you know, they really endured. It was very rough. It was very rough what they went through to get here to the United States and what they had to endure down in that steerage area. It broke my heart. It broke my heart. It felt so inhumane.
So there was some interchange on the memories of Little Italy. See. And
diceva Kim che avevano
delle particular image right here is
quello che hanno dovuto passare questi antenati.
The tenement houses that that Joe Salerno, your ancestor, right? He had this building, as far as we can tell.
Yes. Questo era una building che possedevano i Salerno, dove venivano stipate le persone. Does this building still exist? No, no, right?
No, this is long gone.
So there were people that were concentrated and hosted at the beginning?
Mm-hmm. Yes, this is where a lot of the recent immigrants would stay in this building, mm-hmm. in these tenement apartments.
Piccoli appartamenti.
So what I'm trying to figure out, though, is whether this was on the corner of 6th and Pierce or whether it was on the corner of 6th and Pacific, because what I am seeing from the United States Census is that the address was actually 1121 6th Street, which is actually 6th and Pacific. But I'm pretty sure this is an image of those tenement houses. And when you go in and you look at this link, you'll see all the other images that are associated with the tenement houses that 6th and Pierce.
This seems to be in Mog, like a...
It is mud.
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 È tutto di fango per terra.
If it's 6th and Pacific, well, it said 6th and Pierce.
It's a tenement house.
Come?
That's just a tenement house.
Tenement?
Tenement.
Oh, like apartments. Apartments.
Come appartamento, tipo condominio.
Yeah, that's too nice. They're not apartments. They're shacks.
They were like four pieces of wood, one on the top of the other one.
Right.
Well, but then there's
cheating. I mean, with the snow.
But there were places for families where they had, you know, a bedroom for their children, and you know, or you know, people were able to have their families and, you know, in a bedroom or so. And I don't understand which direction this is, but none of this looks familiar to me. because that's just right down.
Stuff got torn down. Yeah,
I know so, what alley this is.
It looks like the Pierce Street where my great grandfather had his house, exactly where Charles Vendetti has his house. Yeah.
It spills out that, there.
Let's imagine that Charles Vendetti's house is the one on the right. It seems that this picture has been taken in a couple of houses on the left, quite in front of Santa Lucia Hall.
If you type in 1121 South 6th Street and you do the map, it comes up right on the corner of 6th and Pierce. And actually, that building right now is the garage that we use to store everything for the festival. It's right there on the corner.
I slept in that house.
Yeah, it's right on the corner, 6th and Pierce.
Sì.
I'll bring
you by it. Incredibile. But now the level is different. I mean, I don't know.
Yeah, no, that's not Charlie's. That's it's a little east. It's a little east of where you were at.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
It's that like L
the following block, maybe.
Yes.
I'll take you by it.
Va bene.
Charlie's house is up on 8th Street.
Yeah.
And Charlie's house belonged to the family Carlentini, and he was a winemaker. He used to make wine in the basement. So probably 100 years ago, that house was there, isn't it?
This is old.
Oh,
yeah. That old?
Yeah. What was the address on that? Because I had people actually in my tree with people that lived there.
Oh,
that's 21 South 6th.
Which address, Jim?
This is the one where Eleonora stayed at.
Yeah.
Okay.
Early Venditti's.
You know, it's on the, okay, it's right on the corner of 9th and Pierce, and it is on the northeast corner.
Yeah. Yeah, and I can't remember what the address is.
I don't remember what the address is, but
me neither.
My goodness, they redid that house, and that house is just beautiful inside, isn't it, Eleonora?
See, and Charlie, he made a beautiful album where it collects the pictures of the restoration, how it was before, and the work in progress, and now how it is. So they made an excellent job.
The address is 823 Pierce Street.
That's okay. About right.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, io vi saluto perché sono troppo stanca stasera.
Va bene, Silvana, cara, grazie.
Ciao.
Un abbraccio.
Ciao a tutti.
Ci vediamo presto.
A buccheri.
Augurkide.
Mi stai venendo a toccare. Buonanotte.
Ciao.
Buon pomeriggio poi per me. Buonanotte.
Buonanotte. Ciao. That's one of the few times that I'm not sleepy. I'm super active now.
One of the other things that I started chatting with Francesco Spilio. He does a lot of posts on Sadie Carlentini.
See, he likes history. He has an interesting eye. He likes to share interesting post topics that I like. See.
And yeah, He does some interesting storytelling, and so I thought it'd be interesting to at least get his pedigree chart in there. And so I was able to find his grandparents, or a couple of them at least, in the Carlentini Cemetery.
Yeah.
That's just such a huge resource to us to have that cemetery database. Mm-hmm. I want to thank Eleonora for getting Nuccio Costa involved. I want to thank Mary Kay and Monica and Nick T and anybody else that was involved in the transcriptions. That was
we can say
I use it almost every day.
How do you access that database one more time, Nick?
It's findagrave.com. Carlentini.
You can say that you have digitalized the first cemetery in Italy in an American website.
It's amazing resource. So I want to approach Nuccio for Lentini. I thought I'd wait until the weather cools off.
Let's collect some donation first for Carlentini, and he might feel more encouraged, let's say. Well, we can use it, for example, if we want, if we sell something during the festival, we can use those money for the digitalization of the cemetery. Sherry, for example, made those nice, how do you call them?
Coasters,
whatever mm-hmm. they are, just to put your glass of wine on top that are, we can create items like that or just accept the donations. I think it's one of the priority. And if we want to have a Lentini, it will take, 3 months minimum. It's bigger than Carlentini, 3 months of a lot of work. So we have to be able to, let's say, thank this guy back. Unless he is happy in volunteering, we would be more than happy.
And the other person I've been talking to this week is Els.
Ciao, Monica. Who?
You guys know Els? Els?
Ah, yeah, of course. Sissi, I will meet her in the next day. So she's still here. She will leave in 2 weeks. She will spend a month, I think, in Carlentini, 1 or 2 months. She rents a little house. Elsa Di Maria Sofia.
Yeah, let me show you her tree. I can find it here.
I didn't know that the naturalization papers were so small. Really? Yeah, I can say.
And then that's how he got the naturalization of the year. Yeah. So you have to put in a request for it, pay your money. Now I gotta pay more money.
This is like a life effort.
I'm talking to my brother. When Nietzsche was like, oh, yeah. My brother's like, do you have the originals?
I got Bruno, which they're Brunos. We have Lentini Brunos. I have Lentini Brunos in my tree.
But my electrician.
Brunos came from Mazzara del Vallo in Trapani province. Which is it's right next door to Marsala on the water.
Yes.
So this woman here is kind of the
Maria Passante
protector because she was a widow when she married Vincenzo Bruno, but before that she was married to Vito Castelli. And so Niccolo Castelli remained in Sicily and Pietro, he immigrated and they're together on the passenger list. So that's been kind of an interesting story. And I just found her obituary for Maria Passante. And it's interesting because it says survived by 3 sons, Pete, who at that time was in New York, Niccolo, and Matthew or Mateo of Omaha. And then there was a Filipina Messina who was in South America. I hit a dead end on this one here, but in another, like her husband's obituary, it says that she was married to a guy named Philip Messina, and her name was Filipina, which is kind of odd, but.
It would be like Filippo Filipina.
Makes
sense.
Her husband, see if I can find that. Her husband's obituary. Vincenzo died quite a bit earlier. And he was one of the few that kept Vincenzo. A lot of them changed to James. And that That was kind of interesting that that seems to be the trend. And I know Donna and I had this conversation about Vincenzo versus James. But that's pretty common. And he's survived by his wife, Maria, a son, Matteo, two stepsons, Pietro and Carl. I don't know what happened to Carl because he wasn't alive at the time of his mother's death. And one stepdaughter, Mrs. Philip Messina.
Probably the same one that was from South America.
Yeah, that's definitely right. And I've been trying to track her down, Filipina, but not with a lot of success. You can see her while here.
What happened to Frank Messina?
Frank Messina, California.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Well, Jim and I have been having a little chat with him too.
The architect of San Francisco Bay.
Yeah, I think he's, I don't know, he's a little bit.
He didn't like the Zoom that much, let's say. He doesn't get along pretty well with technology. I don't blame him.
Yeah,
it's another generation.
Hopefully we're still around.
Yeah.
I thought this might be Filipina's husband, but I haven't decided that it's him for sure. But this guy was working as a barber for Tony Marchese. Hmm. He's listed as a barber in the city directory.
I know Mike Messina. He's from Omaha. His father was a barber and his name was Peter Messina. And Mike's mother's name, I think, was Frances. I have no idea what her maiden name was.
Hmm. Yeah, here's the Messinas in, what year was this? 1941.
Frank Messina's father was a barber.
Yeah, this is Frank's father right here, Alfio Messina, and his wife Grace or Grazia. They lived at 2705 South 10th. And
Nelly, Peter.
Actually, no, that was his barbershop. Was at 2705, and his house is at.
A little bit further down on 10.
Bancroft.
Yeah.
Bancroft.
Yeah, 2705. Well, actually, I think.
Here.
There's a barbershop. Yeah, 2705 is right there on the corner. They closed the pharmacy there last fall.
Ed's closed?
What's that?
Ed's pharmacy closed?
Yeah, they closed last year. They couldn't afford.
He retired.
No, Ed retired. Somebody
else. Rob Albers owns the pharmacy.
Rob sold it.
To Jason.
And the new guy, he just couldn't make a living out of it. He says there's just wasn't enough money from the insurance. To actually make it worthwhile, so.
Yeah.
There's the Peter and Francis Messina on North 20th. Those are the people that I know are new, and I know their son.
North 20th.
On North 20th, yeah. They were the North Omaha Italians.
Michael.
So Philip was working for Antonio Marchese, and he was residing on Jones, 2556 Jones. Then we have down here Silvers. That's actually our friend Frank Messina's uncle. He was a hairdresser. And his wife, Sarah, is a Damari.
That's Frank's brother.
Oh, that's Frank's brother?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So let me understand. What's that? Is a city direction? Directories means that you were looking for the address of someone, you had like in a book, like in the book numbers? Mm-hmm. And you?
Yeah, well, these got started before telephone books.
Yeah.
You know, we used to have telephone books where you would look up somebody's telephone number and it also have their address. Well, before that, they had city directories, and it was similar. You know, if you wanted to look up somebody's address and then go visit them, you could do it in the city directory.
I'm surprised that because they wrote down as well their employment.
Yeah.
Right.
Handler. Yes. Like to let everybody know your businesses.
Well, and it was part of how you advertised as well. And sometimes, like see on the corners, on the edges here, they have advertisements for various businesses.
Very smart.
It could be started with the phone books as well after the phone books came out.
Mortuary, a lot of mortuaries. Some of them
still do it by parish and churches.
Here's this is 41. Now the directories were two different ways. They had it alphabetically,
mm-hmm.
like this, and then they had it by street numbers. And you know, I think if you look around page 450 to 500, you'll see addresses where they just go up like, you know, down 10th Street. And you could look up 2741 South 10th Street in that part of the directory, and it will, you know, tell you who lives there.
Later on, they had phone numbers. You could look up by phone number.
Yeah.
So one of the things to look for in these city directories is who all is residing at the same address. So we know Frank's father, Alfio, was residing at 2741.
That's South Town. Ditto.
And then if you go down here, you see, Nelly is also at 2741.
This is 2705.
Well, our older people have this.
No, that's the barber shop.
I haven't seen one in years. I was surprised to get
2741 is the house. The H means house.
God.
And usually the business address is given first and then the house, or R for residence sometimes. Like, see Rosary that's living at 2741?
That's his sister.
That's his sister. Nellie is his sister.
They had a lot of little houses in the back. And that's probably what that R is for rear. Or maybe residents. No. Okay.
It just means that they're residing.
Yeah. Okay.
If there is an H, that means he's the homeowner.
No.
All right. Sounds reasonable.
That's cool.
But yeah, these are packed with information, and like Jim was saying about the. They call them, sometimes they call them street directories or reverse directories.
Start around 450 or so.
We'll see how accurate Jim is at 450.
On it.
Okay, well, here you go. Street and Avenue Guide. You pegged it there, Jim. A directory of householders, occupants of office buildings, and other business places, including a complete street and avenue guide.
Okay, guys, I will go. Sherry has things to let me do. If you're
okay, now we're after 4 o'clock, so we should probably go. But this is what, if you were looking on.
Well, this tells you where the streets are. Those are the streets.
Yeah.
We're from Dodge, center of town.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go farther along. A couple more pages and you start into the directory itself.
Yeah.
So this, if you can find the street name, like here's Ames Avenue, and it lists everybody that's living on Ames Avenue. So you could do that for a particular year, say for Pierce Street, and get everybody that was living on Pierce Street.
Or your neighbors.
That's probably a ways down there. So it's, what do you say, Jim? 500, 550?
For South 10th Street?
No, for Pierce.
Oh, Pierce. I don't know. Go.
Well, let's try 500 and see what we get.
Yeah.
No.
It's more like 11, 12.
Yeah, know. Probably 11.
So see this is Lincoln here. Lincoln Boulevard. They're alphabetical.
That's north.
And, so if we go to
another 15 or so.
It was a matter of north or south. They're listed by alphabetical order. So you can't north and south and between them.
Williams is 1400 south. And Pierce is just about three blocks from there. So about 1100.
It doesn't matter what south or north, it's by alphabetical order. So you can have one north street and one south street next to each other.
There's an abbreviation guide at the front of the book, yeah. I believe, because the H stands for household or house.
You gotta go back because you're on the R's.
Householder.
And so we're on Toppleton right at the moment.
Okay, yeah, you're getting closer now. I would just stop one or two.
Poppleton, yes. You're one over.
Pierce.
You're one north.
These are alphabetical.
They're alphabetical and then by street number. So there's Park Wild. Where's Pierce?
North
Pierce. And they start at
right here.
Pierce.
Those are
eight.
You see it? I don't see it.
I what just seen it. For? Pierce. I
no,
just
Pierce seen is it. Right on
there. It is. Okay, here's Pierce. From 1200 South 3rd West to South 66.
With Anthony Maganaro, 602, right there.
Yeah, there's the drugstore that we were just talking about.
Oh, there's my Uncle Louie. Salerno. There's Sam.
Adolfo Scamparino. There's a name for you.
Salerno Lewis.
Here's a grocery store, James Ficanti's grocery store at 616.
Ciao, guys.
Ciao.
Hi, y'all. See you next weekend.
Okay. Bye. Here's That's Joe how- Piccolo's grocery store. So this gives you a real snapshot of what Pierce Street was in 1941.
Yeah,
well, I'm not sure that's a grocery store because GR, that abbreviation says grocer.
Yeah, GRO right. Is a grocer.
Yeah, that yeah, might grocery. Be an occupation.
Yeah, it was a grocery store at 714.
Yes.
He was a grocer, yes, but he had a grocery store in the front of his house.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So the number there, is that the household? Number of people in the household. It has Piccolo.
Good question. I don't know.
It kind of.
I don't see how because how can you have 12 people in one? At 721, it says 12 people. If that's what that means.
Hey.
Could be.
I don't know. Vacant.
I know my grandfather, they had three families living in that house.
Yeah. I don't know. Crawley's.
Are you still with us?
So you didn't go down far enough, 822. Next column. Who's
Carlentini.
Carlentini.
There's Angelo Buda's grocery store.
Mr. Buda.
And Frank Gemma's filling station in 1941. On the corner of Pierce and South 10th.
See, Pierce Street is 1,200 blocks. It's 12 blocks south of Dodge Street. So it's the 1,200 block south of Dodge.
Right.
1 mile.
That's what it says.
Yeah. I figured it was 11 or 12 because Williams is 14.
And Pacific is 11.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, these really tell the tale. Okay, well, we're beyond our time, folks. So,
all right. Thank you all. Thanks.
As always, it's great fun. And see y'all in Omaha in a week and a half, or not all of you, but a lot of you.
I'm here.
Are we here in Omaha already, Jim?
Yes, I'm in Omaha.
Have a great time, Nick.
Thank you, Fred.
I'll start making some notes.
Are you having this next week, Nick?
I'm going to be back in California in October for my wife's 50th reunion at Elk Grove High School.
Nice. Hey, well, if you're near Palo Alto, come by Stanford. Love to show you around.
Oh, I'd love to see it.
Fred.
Yes. Tell her that we've been invited.
You grew up in Westgate, right?
Yes.
Where did you live in Westgate?
Corner of Spring Street and Westgate Road.
Oh, okay. Because I stay at my niece's when I come, and she is 7917 Spring Circle in Westgate. Mm. Yeah, so in the neighborhood where you moved to from.
Yeah.
Were you there? Was your parents there during the tornado?
Yeah, 75? I was in the fourth grade.
Were you? Okay. Yeah,
my dad moved his florist. When we moved out to Westgate, he moved the florist that was on 13th and Martha to, which was Gaeta's there on 85th and Frederick right there. You know what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Where Gaeta's was? That's where his store was there. And him and Frank Piccolo were outside because there was no basement when that thing was coming. And he saw it go to Westgate. And he hauled ass running up Haskell. And then my cousin Rosemary Salonicho, their house was blown across the street. He saw they were okay. Then he went down the street and hung a left at Westgate Road. And
yeah, because my niece's house was a new build. It was one of the houses that was taken out during the tornado on May 6th of 75.
Nick, that was insane. So I've lived through two major ones. A tornado and the 89 earthquake out here.
Oh yeah, 89, October 89.
Yeah, it was
that tornado.
Did not miss either one of those. Were not very fun.
No, that was a big one. Yeah.
At least the tornado you knew was coming. The earthquake you never know it's coming.
You didn't know, and it came right at the right when people were getting off work. It hit like right around 5 p.m.
And this time here. Both our pro teams are playing in the World Series. It was Giants and A's. It couldn't have happened at a worse time.
Yes, that's right. It was, yes. That's right. Yeah.
I remember that watching on TV.
October 89.
Yeah, I remember watching it.
Yeah. I remember standing up and feeling that there was, that I saw the trees moving and I felt no wind and realized I thought I was on a boat because I was going like this. It was the ground rolling.
Yeah. Yeah.
We felt it all the way over in Reno.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah.
I remember going to a Dodgers game and sitting clear up high in the bleachers and thinking, what if an earthquake happens? How far am I going to fall?
Hold on. Yeah, knock on wood. I haven't felt anything for a long, long, long time. So. Anyway, so they have the retro, all the freeways out here and all these buildings. Yeah. So on the most part, everything held up. It was the stuff that wasn't on bedrock. So the district in San Francisco was built on landfill from the 06 earthquake. That's what burned and fell.
Right.
But all the downtown, all the financial district, everything was good because it was all built on bedrock after 1906.
My mom had just gotten off the elevator in the financial district where she was working for a publisher. And she stepped outside and the cranes on the top of the other buildings were teetering. And she managed to get on the first bus out of San Francisco. The people that got on the elevator after she got off were stuck for over 24 hours. Whoa.
Was it 1989?
Yes, that was in October of 89.
Yep, the first week.
Yeah.
Interesting times.
That's what brought me back to San Francisco was commissioning the new state building that had been seismically retrofitted. I got to open that building and hire the staff, and that was fun times. But it was like a war zone down there because everything had construction fence around it. The city hall, the state building, everything there on Civic Center was just under construction.
Yeah, well, it's not the same place. Even today, it's a little disappointed with the city's turned into.
It is. It's sad.
Yeah.
I love that city.
I do, too. Sad. I do, too. But North Beach is doing good. No one's screwing around with the Italians down there. They keep it clean. And Dean went down there. He saw it.
He had a shooting, though.
Yeah, that's going to happen. That's going to happen.
Great restaurants down there.
All right.
All right, guys. Thanks. Kim, good to see you. Have fun. It's all Lucia in your reunion. Tom, okay. See you. Bobby, Connie, Mary, Dean, Nick. Good to see you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.